Hello, and welcome back to On Bach's Time, His Life in Music. I'm Sophia Mitzik. Today, our final class will center on Bach's cantata journey and the Mass in B minor. Hosted by the Saskatoon Symphony Orchestra in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, we're broadcasting live from the Saskatoon Symphony office. We're on Treaty 6 territory and the homeland of the Métis. In the last 5 weeks, we've explored the spectrum of Johann Sebastian Bach's musical activities. One can say he's the complete musician par excellence, as the leading keyboard virtuoso of his time, as a renowned organ expert, a composer versed in every genre, as an experienced director of vocal and instrumental ensembles, and as a dedicated music teacher. Throughout his career, and this was atypical of his era, Bach was able to carry out various projects at once, some which enhanced his held positions and others which were outside his official obligations, yet remained consistent with his artistic goals. Bach's life in music was all-encompassing, from developing instruments to making them available. In addition to his highly active musical output, the ever-enterprising composer also ran an instrumental rental and commission sales. Having had a sizable collection in his home, his estate catalog lists at least 8 harpsichords, a pedal harpsichord, 2 lute claviers, violins, violas, a spinet, viola pomposa, cellos, a viola da gamba, and a lute, an entire small orchestra under his roof. While some instruments were used for his family, instructional purposes, and to supplement the collegium musicum or church instruments, some of the keyboard instruments were also rented out. Bach also ran a small book and score sales operation where his own publications, including volumes of the Klavierübung, as well as works by his sons, colleagues, and students were for sale. From a young age, we remember Bach was interested in the developing technology of music instruments, organ particularly at first, and later his connections with instrument makers opened opportunities for him to experiment with new instrument designs. He played a significant role in the development of new keyboard instruments, such as the lute clavier, which is like the harpsichord, but with gut strings, and as well the forte piano, which was a prototype for the modern grand piano. The lute clavier was a short-lived keyboard variety, and much more pivotal was Bach's involvement with Gottfried Silbermann, the Saxon organ builder and keyboard maker. Silbermann made important refinements to the forte piano, the instrument with controllable hammers that allowed for gradations of forte and piano, loud and soft dynamics. He improved upon Bartolomeo Cristofori's original design and of the forte piano, and specifically the hammer action and sound quality. Silbermann received critical input from Bach after the original model in the early 1730s. According to a report by the German composer, organist, and writer Johann Friedrich Agricola, Bach praised, indeed admired its tone, but he complained that it was too weak in the high register and too hard to play. Silbermann, however upset he was by this, didn't feel Bach was wrong. Years later, he showed his recent workmanship to Bach, who upon examining it, gave it the forte piano, gave it his complete approval. This new and upgraded version was introduced in the mid-1740s and was played by Bach at the court of King Friedrich of Prussia in 1747. Bach also helped market these instruments at the trade fair in Leipzig. All of these diverse activities of Bach's may seem like an unmanageable workload. At the school, university, collegium, his unparalleled musical creations, and interest in the development of instruments, yet he was still left enough time to bring a bird and flowers for his beloved Anna Magdalena. Further to our discussion last week on the Goldberg Variations, I wanted to speak about Bach's view of harmony and the nature of music. how the connection between consonances and dissonances was governed by counterpoint. Counterpoint had a timelessness which needed to be upheld through evolving techniques, styles, and manners of composing. This is especially evident when we look at the inclusion of the musical form, the quadlibet, in the 30th variation of the Goldberg variations. A quadlibet is Latin for whatever you wish, from quad, meaning what, and libet, pleases, what pleases. It's a lighthearted, humorous work that combines several different melodies, often popular tunes, and enhances them with the time-tested principles of counterpoint. In this variation, Bach, ever innovating, departs from the established form and function of the quadlibet and goes beyond the usual silly non sequitur combination of folk song quotes. The folk song quotes Bach that Bach uses offer comic relief, balance, and contrast in a work designed for serious study and practice by musicians and composers. In variation number 30, the first of two famous folk songs quoted is Ich bin so lang nicht bei dir gewesen, I have so long been away from you, and begins with the very first note in the tenor. And now Bach makes full use of the folk song Kraut und Rüben, cabbage and turnips, and quotes the first verse in its entirety. We hear that in the next measure. And now, all together, let's listen to the variation. Only be Glenn Gould. Moving to the topic of cantatas, Bach wrote over 200 church cantatas. The modern German church cantata originated in 1700 near Weimar at the neighboring court of Saxe-Weissenfels. Johann Philipp Krieger, as Kapellmeister there, set to music the text of Gesliche Kantate statt einer Kirchenmusik, sacred cantatas in place of liturgical music, written by the young Lutheran theologian poet Erman Neumeister. Neumeister was a pivotal figure. His innovative collection of sacred poems were modeled after the libretto of the Italian secular cantata. He also adopted the new name of cantata instead of the standard German Kirchenmusik, church music. He made use of existing types of metric and rhymed verse found in the Italian cantatas, and additionally those used in opera librettos, such as recitatives, arias, and derivatives of the 17th century Italian madrigal, a musical genre for voices set mostly to secular poetry. Not only did the Renaissance madrigal become the dominant kind of secular music in Italy, but during the course of the 16th century, it was a progressive and experimental genre affecting both secular and sacred music throughout Europe. The aesthetic of the madrigal was grounded in the universal concept that music intensifies the emotional and intellectual meaning of poetry or text. And madrigal composers were quite original and willing in seeking expressive ways to match music to text. Returning to the poet Neumeister, in view of the madrigalistic poetry enhancing overall expression and communication, it seemed quite suitable for spiritual meditations to be set to music. And so Following was the church's poetically driven decision to embrace the recitative aria form, which would revolutionize the style of church music and intertwine it with the world of opera. Before the second decade of the 18th century, church music was composed in the manner of vocal concerto or concertato motet and lacked a formal design. From 1710 and on, however, Neumeister's modern cantata form, the church cantata form, that was accepted and distributed by the taste-setting aristocracy, would set the standard. Bach's pre-Weimar cantatas are in the former form because it wasn't until his post in Weimar that he had the opportunity to set madrigal poems to music. Two cantatas from the Weimar period written in the new form are the cantata Himmelskönig, King of Heaven, and the cantata Weinen, Klagen, Sorgen, Sagen, which means weeping, lamenting, worrying, fearing. Let's listen to the chorus from the cantata Weinen, Klagen, Sorgen, Sagen, sung by the J.S. Bach Society. I chose this cantata to listen to for a couple of reasons, as it was also inspired. It also inspired a solo piano work by Franz Liszt of the same name, which I have performed. In previous classes, I've mentioned influential composers on Bach, and now here is one of many works Bach inspired. Liszt wrote a set of variations on this theme of Weinen, Klagen, Sorgen, Sagen, following the death of his elder daughter Blandine in 1862. Liszt found in the first movement of Bach's cantata a vehicle for his grief, and he composed his own variations on its ground bass. Liszt took the chromatic bass line from the opening chorus that you just heard of Bach's cantata, and a very similar part from the Crucifixus of the Mass in B minor as the basis of the work. Here's the opening a la Liszt. Expanded what was initially a prelude on the chorus and the Crucifixus into an extended elegy in a set of 30 variations using the sinking, grieving chromatic line. The final variation is demonstrative, a contrast before a wayward recitative line which ushers in a chorale tune taken from the final movement of the cantata. The chorale tune is called Was Gott tut, das ist wohlgetan. Here is a recitative that leads into the chorale. As in Bach's cantata, Liszt's variations reverse the sighing sorrows of the opening and ends with hopeful affirmation. Let's return to Bach's cantata journey. In his Weimar period, 1708 to 1717, he was writing a cantata about once a month. There were two major factors stimulating Bach's interest in the cantata. Most important was his collaboration with Salomo Franck, an erudite poet who would provide librettos for almost all of Bach's cantata, written from 1714 and on, including Weinen, Sorgen, Sagen, which we just heard. The high quality of form and content, elegance of Franck's language, and the theological message of the text supplied Bach with a wonderful vehicle for his musical thought. The other significant factor was that Bach had a highly professional, competent, and versatile Kapelle ensemble to work with in Weimar. The palace church was available for the performances as well, providing a convivial and intimate space. This performance space accounts for the scoring of a smaller, more chamber music-like ensemble. The courses range from the traditional concertato motet, chorale motet, fugue, freer concerto type, to include highly innovative settings, the chorale elaboration in overture style, chaconne with motet, and more. It's notable that the recitatives and arias required as much technical proficiency as the instrumental parts demanded from their players. In terms of style, from 1714 and on, the Italian manner of melodic declamation prevailed and was heard in expansive vocal duets and textures. Altogether, the impressive collection of cantatas from 1713 to 1716 are evidence of Bach's systematic exploration of nearly all compositional possibilities woven into vocal instrumental music, possibilities in genre, form, technique, scoring, texture, and more narrowly, key choices, rhythmic metric design, and harmonic structure. Bach met the challenge to match his complex musical language with the profound prose and poetry based on biblical quotations, modern poetic verses, and traditional hymns. It's safe to say that with cantata performances under Bach's direction, that the Kapelle ensemble would be led by the concertmaster, that is, the first violin played by Bach. Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach had written, "In his youth and until the approach of old age, Bach played the violin cleanly and penetratingly, and thus kept the orchestra in better order than he could have done on the harpsichord." Upon Bach's promotion to concertmaster while living in Weimar in 1714, in the performance of his first cantata, he presented himself simultaneously as composer, concertmaster, and violin soloist. In his new role, the special performance of this cantata, Hymnus Konig sei Willkommen, and King of Heaven, welcome. For the double feast day of Palm Sunday and the Annunciation, was prepared to make a statement. This is evident by the grandiose overall design and the intent to present the court capelle at its very best. Let's listen to the opening movement of the cantata, Himoskonik Zai Vilkomen, which is in sonata form. Designed as an overture, the sonata features a violin and recorder duo in concerted manner, as the duo is accompanied almost exclusively by plucked strings. This distinct sound draws attention quickly to the unfolding musical narrative, as well as the prominent leading role of the concertmaster, that would have been Bach. Here is the Monteverdi Choir and the English Baroque soloists led by John Elliott Gardiner. Let's jump ahead a little to Bach's first Christmas season in Leipzig, when he set out on an ambitious musical program. On the first Sunday in Advent, he repeated performances of cantatas written during his Weimar period to allow himself more time to compose new works before Christmas. These new works included the Magnificat and six cantatas that were all to be rehearsed and prepared and performed within a 2-week span. Lavishly scored, the Magnificat is his only 5-voiced concerted piece written before the Mass in B minor. The 6 cantatas are scored variously, with some designed intentionally to not overstrain the choir. Just for example, there is a challenging opening chorus from the cantata, Sehet welch eine Liebe, Behold, what a love, which includes cornetto and trombones. Bach scored the instrumental ensemble to support the choristers by having the instruments double the parts. And this would also help compensate for the lack of any of rehearsal time. Let's listen to this cantata chorus, and also performed by the English Baroque soloists, Monteverdi Choir, under the direction of John Elliott Gardiner. The 1720s were by far Bach's most productive cantata writing period. During this time, his aims were to provide his office with a sizable amount of working repertoire to draw from later, and he set technical and artistic goals for the individual cycles in order to explore the flexible genre and push its limits. In 1723, at the beginning of his cantorship at St. Thomas, Bach decided to supply the 2 main churches with works of his own. Unlike any of his predecessors in Leipzig, he embarked, or rather continued, his cantata journey in providing a cantata, a piece of concerted music, for every Sunday and a feast day of the ecclesiastical year, with the exception of the Lenten weeks preceding Christmas and Easter, when concerted music was traditionally suspended. This great task required no less than 60 cantatas annually. At that time, the cantata had become the principal music piece in the liturgy of the Mass, the niche which was formerly filled by the Gospel motet. The motet generally highlighted one or more verses from the Bible. After 1700, the cantata entered the scene with multi-sectional poetry that interpreted the biblical passage, thus did more than merely highlight it. Bach probably realized the great pressure put on himself in undertaking the task to compose a new cantata on a weekly basis. And for a good stretch of time in the 1720s, he did so. His post didn't require these weekly compositions of him, nor performances of such technically challenging large-scale works. Exceeding expectations were his decision. After 1739, however, Bach minimally expanded his repertoire for the church. His other activity in that realm involved modifying older works, such as in their instrumentation. The only evidence of a cantata movement composed after 1740 is the single aria, Bekennen will ich seinen Namen, I shall acknowledge his name, BWV 200, which dates to about 1742. Let's listen to a recording of this, again with the Monteverdi Choir, English Baroque soloists, and John Elliott Gardiner. This quite calming or mellowing music to listen to. But first, let's talk about coffee. Coffee became part of the Leipzig life of 1694, causing much controversy. The beloved drink started to be served at the establishment Zum Kaffeebaum, in English, to the coffee tree, which is still open today. The controversy was due to coffee's association with the exotic Turkish lifestyle. Nonetheless, it became a regulated substance while remaining a topic of debate. Initially, women were excluded from public coffee houses and would instead form coffee circles at their homes to ensure that they could still enjoy this exotic beverage. In this coffee climate, Bach's humorous coffee cantata, a secular cantata, elaborates on the dangers of coffee, where the father of a coffee-addicted daughter tries to forbid her from marrying if she doesn't give it up. However, in the final recitative, the daughter, in an aside, lets the audience know she will only marry one who allows her to drink her coffee. So the narrator sings as the daughter, and it is written also in the marriage contract that I shall be permitted to make coffee whenever I want. Let's listen to the chorus, which follows, with the soprano, the daughter, tenor, narrator, and the bass, sung by the daughter's father. And they will sing on this text, the cat does not leave the mouse. Young ladies remain coffee addicts. The mother loves her cup of coffee. The grandmother drank it also. Who can blame the daughters? Die Mutter lovely video recording was presented by the Netherlands Bach Society. Notwithstanding the heterogeneous nature of the cantatas, the first cycle composed in Leipzig laid down some characteristic features which remained constant through the cantata repertoire that Bach produced in Leipzig. These features include the grand style choral opening and the simple and expressive four-part chorales which close the cantata. The choral and instrumental ensembles grew from those in Weimar, and even for the Weimar cantatas to be performed in Leipzig, instruments were added and the string section was enlarged. While the scoring of the Weimar cantatas are colorful and varied, Bach continued to explore new sonorities and combinations of instruments. What is striking is that Bach's compositional goals remained unchanged: to expand the cantata genre by broadening the scope in every possible way. He couldn't just write aria after aria, chorale after chorale, cantata after cantata. Bach constructed a musical apparatus integrating orchestra and chorus for all parts to fully engage in the musical interpretation of the text, resulting in expansive and vigorous expression. Looking at the series of newly composed cantatas in Leipzig, the cantata Herr gehe nicht ins Gericht mit deinem Knecht, Lord, do not pass judgment on your servant, and Schau doch und seh it, behold and see if there be any sorrow, these cantatas reach a new height of artistry, demonstrating sophisticated design, gripping rhetorical power, and intense expression in the opening choruses. Let's listen to this opening of the cantata 46, Behold, BWV 46, Behold and see if there be any sorrow, as it contains musical material that Bach later incorporated in his Mass in B minor in the Gloria section, which will be our next topic of discussion. Here is the opening sung by the J.S. Bach Foundation. So just a last note on the cantatas before we move to the Mass. Bach's musical language in the cantatas from the Leipzig period also saw the development of interpretive imagery, where the music translates the poetic text into an understandable musical idea. For example, in the aria, Wie sie trennen und wanken, meaning how tremble and waver, from the cantata Herr gehe nicht ins Gericht, we hear this evocative music. So we can hear the trembling and wavering in the layered score, wavering thoughts in the gestures between soprano and oboe, and the trembling in a string accompaniment on a tremolo figure. We hear the wavering and the trembling in the string accompaniment. Let's listen to this with a whole ensemble, the Netherlands Bach Society. Thank you. Bach in the position of cantor was inconceivable in his last decade of life. At the age of 55 and in good health, permission to retire in good standing would only be granted under exceptional circumstances. With a growing awareness of how his music would serve as a foundation for music of the new generation and the appointments of his outstanding students to influential positions, this perhaps brought about a changing of the guard, so to speak, as Bach chose to delve deeper in composition. Knowing his Bach school was in good hands may have set the stage for his next masterpieces, The Art of Fugue and the Mass in B minor. In last week's class, we saw how far-reaching the compositional device of a fugue subject can be when inhabiting Bach's thought process. The entire Art of Fugue is derived from the same thematic material. And the resultant movements are more than a study of fugue. It's the Art of Fugue. It's a compendium of concise and detailed information on the subject, and in which Bach illustrates the range of what intense concentration and technical command in instrumental counterpoint can achieve. For Bach, the vocal counterpart of such a large-scale work and most suitable to total contrapuntal treatment was the Mass. With the focus of the B minor Mass being on contrapuntal settings, Bach creates a dynamic interplay between the choral and instrumental counterpoint and integrates many different textures and styles with and without instrumental obbligato, a distinctive instrumental part. In 1733, Bach dedicated a Kyrie Gloria Mass to the electoral court of Saxony at Dresden. A Kyrie is the first sung prayer of the Mass, and the Gloria occurs shortly after. Shortly following the Kyrie in a celebratory praise of God. It is not certain when Bach began expanding on the Kyrie Gloria Mass into a complete Mass setting. It is known that in the late 1730s and early 40s that Bach copied, performed, and studied many Masses by composers, spanning in time from Palestrina to Bach's own contemporaries. Bach performed the six-voice Mis Sacine Nomine by Palestrina, and adding in cornetos, trombones, and continuo, as well as a Misa Sapiente by Antonio Lotti. The Misa Sine Nomine by Palestrina survives in an autographed manuscript by Bach. Let's listen to some of what may have inspired Bach's Mass. Mass's magnificence is evident from the opening measures. It begins with a five-part setting of the text, then is followed by a weighty, mute fugal section with architectural grandeur and complexity. Let's listen to this opening of the Mass now with the Netherlands Bach Society.
Thank you.
The next movement is in the style of a contemporary opera, a gentle duet for sopranos with a charming ritornello for strings doubling the choral parts. The second Kyrie for four-part choir has an intense chromatic fugal subject. This opening group already shows that Bach valued contrasting compositional techniques and styles. It's interesting that the keys of these three sections are B minor, D major, and F sharp minor, outlining the form of a B minor triad. In the Mass in B minor, Bach also added a theological, historical, and compositional dimension not found in the Kyrie Gloria Mass by including a wide span of historical styles of the Mass genre. The Mass in B minor structure is in four parts, starting with the Missa, and then the Symbolum Nisenum. The third part is the Sanctus, and the fourth part is comprised of the Osana, Benedictus, Agnus Dei, and Dona Nobis Pacem. My Latin's a little rusty. Heard in its entirety, the listener may have the impression that this music was building up in Bach his whole life. It may even seem ironic that much of this beloved work was bottom drawer music, which Bach had either set aside earlier or recycled. Most of the Mass's component parts date from various times during his long residence in Leipzig, and which were only assembled to form the complete Mass in his last years. Let's listen to something from each of the sections. First, the Laudamus Te from the Missa features a beautiful soprano solo coupled with a violin in an outpouring of musical religious fervor. Here it is sung by the Netherlands Bach Society. So much vitality in that movement. It's one of my favorites. The second section, Symbolum Nisenum, opens with a credo in which two vibrant fugal choruses burst forth. The credo harks back to the older church style, and the first fugue is based upon a medieval chant. Here, Bach uses musical devices to fully express the character of the text. For instance, imitative counterpoint is used to contrast the text of the expecting and the expected. And a chromatically expressive adagio movement illustrates suffering. And then the vivace movement in an upbeat character conveys the anticipation in the text. Here's the opening of the credo from the same recording by the Netherlands Bach Society. The second section, Symbolum Nisenum, also, we have the chorus Et Incarnatus Est, which conveys intense awe that deepens with despair in the Crucifixus. This chorus is actually reworked from a chorus in the cantata we heard earlier, a bit of the Weinenklagen, Sorgen, Sagen. Here's an excerpt. Can hear that weeping and sorrowfulness from these two note descending slurs, bottom, bottom, creating musical sighs. In the third section, we hear the wonderful Sanctus, an exultant fugue, which was written originally for Christmas Day in 1724. The choir for this movement is divided into six parts. Let's listen. Now let's hear part of the final movement of the Mass, the jubilant final Dona Nobis Pacem. And so these are just snippets of the Mass. One really ought to listen to the entire work for the full experience. The Mass in B minor was actually not performed in its entirety in Bach's lifetime. It's not until 1859, more than a century after his death, that the entire work was performed in a single sitting. One of the most historical of all genres, Bach has reinforced the timelessness of the ancient Mass and of music, which he elevated with his wide spectrum of vocal and instrumental polyphony. It is not known for what occasion Bach wrote the Mass. There is no sign of it being a commission, nor performance of it before his death in 1750. This last choral composition, like the Art of Fugue, is another compendium of historical styles, contrasting sonorities, and vocal compositional devices. He brought all his most inspired creative energy to this work. As far as is known, Bach did not have any ongoing health concerns at any point in his life, with the exception of his final year. On July 28, 1750, less than a year after completing the Mass, Bach died in Leipzig due to complications from treatments following an eye surgery. Bach remains truly a central figure in Western musical tradition. It's interesting that his own surroundings and travels were limited to an area of Germany not spanning more than 100 miles. Though he did not travel far, his legacy expands into the universe, with the universe. With the time left in today's class, I will answer any questions now that there may be. Here's a question. It's come up from Sally. What does Bach's music mean to you personally? That's a really great question. Which almost not sure how to answer. I'm going to mull this over until another question pops up. I do think his music has influenced me too. Well, it can't help but have influenced many other composers and musicians, and why I've pursued a path in music. And why I love the piano. His music is kind of the basis of, well, not the basis of counterpoint, but he really opened so many creative doors for all composers following him. But piano aside, in the keyboard world and what I do aside, his music is a universe. It's like scuba diving. You know, I've never been scuba diving. What I imagine is just, it's just so colorful and just awesome, for lack of better words, and complex, intricate, and a mystery too, in a sense, and it'll be sort of endlessly fascinating. I don't think I could ever tire of listening to Bach and learning about his music. And I have another question. How would you compare the music of Bach to the music of Handel? And then, so how would I compare their music? Well, I would compare also first their difference of repertoire, or what ensembles and solo works they wrote for. I do think Bach wrote a vaster range of works. So we'll probably have to go by genre and say how we compare the different keyboard suites, for example, and the choral works. I'll just peek at this next question here. From Bach's large repertoire, do we know what type of music was most popular during his lifetime? So I would, we'll gather that his music that was most played would be all of his church music and choral works. And I'm willing to bet his secular cantatas were pretty popular as well, like the coffee cantata. And I'm guessing any works that he presented at the Collegium Musicum would be performed probably more than once and really enjoyed. Also, once he started publishing more music, and for example, his the clavier umbangs and the partitas and suites, he more people would have had access to his music, and I'm probably increase their popularity. There was definitely a challenging aspect to performing his works, and it was recorded that back then keyboardists did find his music complex. So I don't think everyone was practicing Bach all the time, because once even it was accessible, there were different styles, maybe lighter styles, people also wanted to play at home. Well, I'm just reading some comments and thank yous for the class. And that's really great to hear. Thank you for sharing your comments. It's been a very memorable experience of reading about Bach and sharing this wonderful music and world with you. I also want to thank, I see a Q&A. I also want to thank the Saskatoon Symphony and Mark Turner for inviting me to give this series of talks on this endlessly fascinating subject. I'm just going to see this. We have another question. Did the common folk of the time also listen to and enjoy Bach's compositions, and how did they access it? I did read that, for instance, in Leipzig, at the churches, the main churches that where Bach had his cantorships, there were four churches in total and two main churches. There were really a large group of people who are different peoples who attended the mass, from the upper echelons to more common people. And the Collegium Musicum, I imagine that was opened as it was, there was coffee house adjacent to anyone who would go, you know, for coffee. I guess it's different back then, but I think it would have been accessible if people had also maybe the access to keyboard and interest in that realm. Thank you everyone for your lovely comments. And yes, I hope to do another series like this as well. That would be great. I have some ideas already. There might be another question then. Okay, so I don't think we maybe have any more questions at this moment. So I just want to say thank you again, everyone, for joining me. And thank you to the Saskatoon Symphony for hosting this series. And it's been just a really memorable and wonderful experience with this music and you all.